Yes, this is about the validation which was made in for Gaia first release. The outline of the talk, I will spend a few minutes on the question of the organization of the validation to show what was the spirit of the work, but also to give proper credit to the people who worked on validation. And then seeing the three different points. First one is the coverage, the completeness at large, intermediate, or small scale of the DR1 data. Then the astrometry for the what concerns the standard uncertainties, the correlations, the parallaxes, and proper motions. And then the photometry, accuracy and precision. So the motivation of the validation is to make an extensive verification of the catalog, because the catalog that you receive is the integration of data coming from several coordination units, which themselves have done their own verification, but at the end the data is integrated, and so we have to check this data before before publishing it. It should be global, it should be transversal, and it's in some sense, although it's in DPAC, it's an independent check of the quality, because in most of the case we have just the same data as the users have. Although the coordination units kindly give some data or advice. And then to give feedback if we find problem. Validation is also an assessment of the statistical properties, and actually that's the goal of this presentation, is to show what has been seen, what has been found on the data, because we used the data 2 months in advance. And we know that this has to be documented, and that the there are a lot of, as we saw, there are a lot of statistical problems that are difficult to interpret. And an important point also is that this work is being done and bound by the Gaia Science Management Plan, meaning that we can do no science with the data beforehand. So that's only validation and no science. So what this implied, to not leave large errors before publication, it means that we have perhaps to filter star if we find problems at the last minute. We have to do a lot of statistical tests, and the fact that we may have to do several iterations needs environment for something automated. As we have to document the properties, we have to make automatic reports and produce this for the documentation. And because it's validation and science, the data stays at ESAC, and there's a full transparency on the tests that we have done. So the validation area has been split in several domains that I will describe quickly. With the goal of having independent validations with different ways to check the data, because the DPAC is organized in terms of instrument or in terms of objects, and we need to be transversal. So the first one is the question of the internal test. There's a lot which can be done with the Gaia data alone, either using the interesting properties of the data. For instance, we know that the parallax is positive, so we can check the negative parallax tail, I will show that. There's a lot of redundancy between the data, between photometry and between photometry and spectroscopy. And so we can check for problems in particular, since we know where we may have problems with Gaia, for instance, the change of window size, gates for bright stars and so on, trying to devote a test specific on that. The second part is based on model. And so you can, of course, think that using a galaxy model to compare to Gaia data is probably useless. Actually, we will see that this is not the case. When you have a model that compares well to the existing data and for which you have some error bars on the model, then you can use it within this error bar. This main idea being, can we interpret structures in the data as already known, or is it artifacts? So I forgot to say that the first one was led by Klaus Fabricius from Barcelona. The data model was led by Annie Robin from Besançon. The use of external data is led by Karine Babuzio in Paris Meudon Observatory. So actually it's quite complicated to compare Gaia to the external data because there's nothing really comparable. And we have many problems of cross-match, Gaia having a better resolution. You are never sure that you are talking of the same objects with Gaia on the one side and the external object. There's a lot of, as you can see in the slides, there's a lot of catalogs, external catalogs, which have been used for astrometry and photometry. And I will show this later. There's also a word package led by Amina Elmi on the question of the statistics. The idea here is to do some data mining and find structures and find whether there are structures inside the noise. And it's also used VAX by Martin Brothers. We have also, led by Sergi Blanco from Geneva, work package on the time series and variability, the motivation being that the variability behavior that we see on the data, is it due to the data itself, or is it due to the instruments, or is it due to the reduction? So try to interpret the periodicities, and for the variable stars themselves, to check whether they have not special properties which could be interpreted as a bias. Led by Antonella Valinari, there is also a work package for clusters because these are places where you get some insights thanks to the square root of the number of objects. And the stars are better known than field stars, and as we can we discussed earlier, they are also in clusters that we may find them, some angular correlations and problem at small scale. So the work done for DR1 was incremental in some sense, thanks to CO3 AGIST team, we could receive three intermediate catalogs, very, very preliminary, to exercise the test. And there's about 80 tests which have been implemented. This is documented, what I will show is documented, and that's a paper which is submitted to ANA in the Gaia group of papers. And there's also some part of it that you can find in the Gaia documentation that no one reads the documentation, but it's here. So what I will show now is what we found on the data. And obviously, by nature, the validation are the bad guys who are trying to find where there can be problems in the data. So I will show the caveat for the users. Do not forget that DR1 and the future of the scientific exploitation will show it. DR1 represents the best to date. And so the small problems that we can see that I will show are only for your information and to interpret correctly the data. The first part is the completeness coverage of the data. So the rationale is that you have seen that making statistical analysis is complicated, so you have to know what are the censorships, what are the truncations. The selection function for Gaia, as we will see, is very hard. The problem associated to that is that the sky in J is not known, not yet known, and this is in particular the case at a small scale. So because the Gaia resolution is much better, that's complicated to find problems. So on large scale, the first point which is interesting, that for the full catalog Air 40 gas, that's the 99% decile percentile of the distribution of magnitude to see what is the limiting magnitude of Gaia. And as you can see, we will reach easily at the end of the mission in a lot of part of the sky, the 21st magnitude. You can also see that in some part of the sky, we are losing one magnitude for the faintest stars. And in the bad window, for instance, we lose nearly two magnitudes. This is not fully uniform in the T-gas data either, and you can see that from the we can go up to 13 magnitude, but it can also, in some places, decrease to 11. And the, as I told before, actually, the galaxy model can give you some insight of that. That's per bin of magnitude from 12 to 19. So you see, obviously, the failures of the model. Namely, there's no imaginary clouds in the galaxy model, obviously. There are problems related to extinction. But beyond this, you can see that starting from magnitude 15, 16, there are lacks of stars that you can see. And you see here the completeness or incompleteness which increase. And it gives you, if you believe in the number of the model, it tells you that you lack 25% of the star beyond the 20th magnitude. If you don't believe in the model, you can do another experiment. It's you count all stars up to a magnitude here 11, and you divide this by a number of stars by at 10.5. And so if you have some incompleteness, it will go onto the blue side. So here, for the moment, you see only the regions where you have a large increase of the number of objects in the bulge, for instance. You see also the effect of the extinction. And then you will see at some point appear when we arrive to magnitude 15, 16. You will see there are some incompleteness which begins to appear. So here, for instance, and then it's more obvious when you go to the faintest magnitudes. So here and here, you can see it's here, there. So without a model, you can see that where you expect problem of completeness. And here you see this red clump is the red clump of LMC. So you get the distance modulus for free, in case you don't know it. So you still see here, and then you see the it's much more obvious now where you have problems. Okay. So it was also compared to external catalogs. So here on the top that's two mass, and below that's UK4. So the sources two mass which are not in Gaia. So you see where you have incompleteness. Where you have also multiple matches in year one. So it can be, obviously, as I said, the fact that this is not the same angular resolution. It can be also a question related to duplicate. I will come to that later. And that you see the same thing for UK4 and also sources in Gaia, sources which are not in UK4. In high density fields, you expect to have problems in terms of completeness. So here you see the completeness fraction in a very dense field that's slightly below 1 million stars per square degree. My point was also that when we say that you have no very blue or very red star, you can see that in effect here. The red points are the points which are not in the in dia one. So you see that this effect here has also an effect on the scientific content. For instance, the red clump in the bulge, which is very redundant, then will not be not be present. And so you have an incompleteness in the bulge, which starts already at magnitude 15. In terms of extended objects, there's a very few galaxies which are in DR1. But for the resolve one, you can see that you have a lot of match which traces their shape. In the TGAS subset, as we learned yesterday, there's only 80% of the Tycho 2 catalog which is present, and here you have the one which are not found, so that's in ecliptic coordinates, and you see the galactic plane here and the bulge here. And also you can see the red star which are missing, and also the very bright which are missing. Hyperpropulsion motion stars, here that's the probability density of for the star in green, which hyperpropulsion star found in Simbad, and red, the one which were not found. So it means that above 3.5 arc second per year, we are clearly missing all of the hyperpropulsion. But even below, there's a fraction of them which are not present. Now at intermediate scale, we also saw that. So thanks to the visualization by André, you can see some empty regions. So that's in very dense field. And it's probably due to lack of onboard resource. The scale here, it's 200 square arc minutes, and it's in a dense field in the plane. You can also see here that's the effect of the scanning law, so that zooming and using the visualization, you can see that you can up to zero, the maximum I think is 0.1 square degree, which where you have no star. And the funny thing is that first time I had not this visualization software, so I made just a cone search here. And I found that. And so I thought it was Gaia Pac-Man who had hidden all of the stars. You can see that also in globular clusters. So that color coded by the number of CCD observations. You can see here the mix of lack of onboard resource and also a problem of scanning law. So the main point is that the selection function is complicated, and it's important to have a look at all kind of parameters you have, special one or photometric one, to know the actual content. At small scale now, so the first good point is that we found no spurious sources. We were frightened to find spurious sources around bright stars, but it had been all that had been filtered beforehand. For instance, we had implemented some tests in terms of trying to find, in terms of uniformity of orientation, some discrepancies, and so here that it's test which detects that, but it's actually not obvious that it was not needed. There was no clear ghost either found around very very bright stars. Now we know the theoretical angular resolution of Gaia, and we know that it's good. For instance, there was an experiment measuring Pluto and Charon separation. So we know it's good, but as you will see, there are problems as a small scale, at small scale. So it's just two fields taken, one at low sparse field at low galactic latitude, and one in the near the disk, and scaled so that we had approximately the same number of objects. So in the high density field, you can see that below, say, 4 arc seconds, you start to have less stars. It's random above, and then below 2 arc seconds, you have even less stars. In the low density field, the non-random is due to substructures which were in the data, but you see a peak here also. So I will first come back to the identity field. So a simple simulation was done, just trying actually taking pairs of stars with magnitude some magnitude difference, and looking how it will go in photometric windows when one is selected and not the other, and so on. And so the simulation reproduces what we see. So the clear answer is that the drop is due between 2 and 4 is due to the fact 4 it's the diagonal of the photometric window. So it explains why we have stars which are missing. And those which survive actually below 2 arc seconds are the pairs for which the two components are of similar magnitude, so that depending on the orientation, one could get the window for itself. It also shows, the simulation also shows that a lot of stars are then rejected, and so this also explains the incompleteness that we have. But to come back to the peak that we saw at for the low density field at low separation, I do some flashback on actually what the validation did before the DR1 data. So what was found before was that there were a lot of duplicate sources, meaning sources at almost the same position and actually the same source. It was the same source, but which received part of the observation only. And it was in particular found here on near the source equatorial pole, where you can see probably the trace of the plates of used in GSC, I guess in the IGSL. So selecting stars with a position which is too close to be true, given the angular resolution of Gaia, and rejecting them make a much nicer figure. And you can see here, also in the field, before and after removing these duplicates. So you see a peak here at small separations, and so the peak, it looks the peak has disappeared. As we will see, it's not fully perfect. The second thing, so it led to a filtering of the stars. Some stars were rejected before the publication. Another rejection came from the fact that in TGAS, you have seen, and it was mentioned also yesterday, that in logarithmic scale, the J distribution, there are stars which are much too faint to be true. And it was found that there were problems with small number of photometric observations or stars which could be which had a color which was strange, and so rejecting these stars was the second filtering which was done at the validation level. Still, that's before and after filtering. You see, still at the faint end of TGAS, you have some faint sources. So that's not a lot. I think that's 250 stars, something like that. But Nate, if you have the question. Of the faintest, yeah, one third may be a wrong type of two star. A larger part may be a wrong cross match in the TGAS solution. So it was the wrong star. There was also the case, but we found one case like that, of one variable which was bright at the Tycho epoch and faint at the Gaia epoch, at least 6 magnitude. But we found only, that's for Laurent. This one is the only one that we found. We have not looked for that. And about this peak here, we had a look, and also we used the Washington Double Star Catalog to check this. So the separation as given by the WDS and the one given by Gaia. So you can see here that some fraction of star with near zero, so same position. And so looking at the stars here, you have most of them are real double stars, but a fraction of them may be duplicates that we did not we have not successful to suppress. So that's good to know that a few of low separation objects may be wrong one. Okay, so after the completeness, the question of the astrometry. I will not advocate why it's important to validate the parallax, but the point is that we have very little to compare with. So the way it is done, it's in two steps. One is stars which are so distant that you can consider that their true parallax is zero at the precision of Gaia, typically QSOs, or LMC, SMC objects. Or stars which are distant enough. And the point being that the sigma pi over pi being fixed by the capabilities of spectrophotometric distances, if you are looking distant enough, you get small error on the photometric parallax. So all the stars which were kept had less than 0.1 mass in the precision of the photometric estimate. First, the distribution in galactic coordinates of the formal uncertainties, just to show that it's dependent on the sky position. So that's for proper motion in alpha and delta, and here in the parallax. This distribution of the precision here as a function of magnitude, here as a function of the number of observations, and here in ecliptic coordinates the distribution of these uncertainties and the dispersion of these uncertainties, just to show that there are places in the skies where it's very varying. So what we did, it's actually not new. It was based on the work done for Hipparchos by Lennart in 1995. It's to use the negative tail of the parallax. So the idea is to deconvolve this tail. On this tail, you have mainly errors of the negative errors of the parallaxes. And so that's a sort of Richardson-Lucy deconvolution algorithms. It was done on Tycho 2 subset and Hipparchos subset. And the result is here. Here is the published standard uncertainty in the catalog. And here the observed dispersion found by the deconvolution algorithm. And you can see that it's for Hipparchos star here and non-Hipparchos, Tycho 2 non-Hipparchos stars here. You can see it stop at 1 milliarc second because all the stars with milliarc second larger than milliarc second uncertainty were not given the 5 parameter solutions. So just a parenthesis, the stars with the largest excess noise may then have received a large standard uncertainty which made them disappear from the TIGAS subset. But also they have a two-parameter solution. So So my postdoc made this work, which was quite complicated, and I made the fit. The fit shows that within the error bars, this is comparable. Okay. The unit weight is about one. It's slightly below, meaning that the formal uncertainties are trustable but slightly pessimistic. If you do not solve for the zero point, but you add an extra dispersion in the sense of this extra variance with a minus C, so you find 0.11 mass extra dispersion. Not extra dispersion, it's negative, so it means that it's too pessimistic. So that's an internal method of testing the precision of the parallax. The catalog also gives correlations, so I tried also to check these correlations. That's not easy because you would need to know, if you want to make correlations, compute correlations between astrometric errors, you need to know the observed astrometric data and the true data. So obviously you do not know the true data. But at least in the LMC and SMC, and neglecting the internal dispersion of the proper motions when using only the Tycho 2 stars, which have a large uncertainties, you can see that correlation between parallax and proper motion, or between proper motion components, between the predicted, the median value of the in the fields and the observed one, it's fully consistent. So it means that in the catalog, also the correlations that you are given, at least here, are fully trustable. To do correctly this job, I should have used also the angular correlations between stars, but since there's no really way to compute the theoretical value of these angular correlations, this was not done, but it's something which is important at small scale. So that was about the uncertainties, so the precision and correlation for the astrometry. Now about the zero point itself. So that's a figure that Xavier showed yesterday. What happens is that there is a special QSO solution with 135,000 stars, QSOs, sorry, which had been performed at the end of the Aegis chain. And so this data, which is not published, and this data, in principle, you see directly the errors because the true parallax being zero. So here that's the median parallaxes found with this data in 2 degrees regions, so over the sky. So obviously, as you can see on the right, QSO cover only part of the sky and very sparse outside. So you have some insight here and here. Nevertheless, you can, it's here, it's the number of observations, and here that's the correlation coefficient between right ascension and parallax. And that's just to show that places where you can find some excursions, some larger positive bias of the parallax are also found, those with a small number of observations. You can clearly see also the ecliptic pole scanning law. You see also this region here, which is here in the... just in with numbers, so that is the correlation between right ascension and parallax, and you can see that there's a strong... you see the effect, it's correlated, I mean, correlation is correlated with the parallaxes. You can also see the effect with a small number of observations where you have a positive systematics and then it decreases. You can see also, it's within the error bars, but you can see for blue and red some problems. So you may wonder, as Lennart rightly said, whether the QSO, which are special objects, this is also can be also been applied to the TIGAST data. One answer is that there are special objects, but their excess noise is not that bad, so the astrometric solution should not be that bad. And but you cannot use the maps which was shown before also, because the TIGAST stars, which are much much brighter, they suffer from many other problems. So you cannot use this map for the brighter stars. You can just use it to get the level of which problem you can have. Another point which shows you that the local variations that you can find are real, it's using selecting stars in the LMC and SMC, you see significant values which are different from the average value that I did not show before. It was here. Yes, that's -0.04 mass. While I'm on the slide, the question that we raised yesterday, there's 10% of the QSO sky which has a systematic above 0.3 mass. So that's frequent. So we have local places where we see that it's different from the global zero point. And also using RAVE data, you can see here, that's in ecliptic coordinates, you can see here that the PSL feature appear. So it's not due to RAVE, it must be due to Gaia. So you can see from all these numbers that there has been a lot of work which has been done to try to estimate the zero point of the parallaxes. On the first line, you see Hipparchos. So obviously, comparing TIGAS with Hipparchos, you will see here the sum of the Gaia zero point and the Hipparchos zero point. And besides, it's marginally consistent with the one I found at the Hipparchos time, unfortunately. And you can see also that there is an extra dispersion. So we knew that the parallax may be slightly, precision may be slightly underestimated, so it's shown here. Because for most of the other tests, you can see the negative sign. And in red, it's when it's significant, and green, when it's not significant. You see the negative sign. So again, it has to be understood as you take the what is the variance that you should add or subtract to the observed variance. So most of the tests show that the uncertainties are slightly pessimistic. So there was, here you have the outliers over the number of objects which have been used. So here that's astrometry, so precise astrometry from VLBI, HST, or Recons, which are nearby stars. And here's the average of all this. But obviously, there's not enough data. Still, you see this value, which is not significant, but close to the one that I showed with the QSOs. Cepheid and RLIRES too. So the zero point is also very consistent with the QSO global zero point. And also showing that there is the uncertainties in TIGAS are slightly pessimistic. It's important to note here that the way it was done on selecting, it was not using all the distribution of the stars. It was selecting only those which had a photometric precision better than 0.1 mass, meaning negligible in front of the TGAS one, so that you can compare safely the two.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
The ones you have listed as HST, what are those?
There's a few parallaxes which I can tell you later.
Okay.
If I find that, because it was work done by Karen Babuzio, but it may be in the it must be in the paper, I will tell you. So we used stars for which we could trust here, for all the spectrophotometric distances, we could trust the distance, we could trust the parallax, the photometric parallax, because the error on it was very small. But when you select a sample, as Gaia, as Xavier told yesterday, when you select a sample on the basis of the photometric error, you can also make a small bias. So just to say that all these comparisons were done properly with taking into account the bias by a Bayesian mission, taking into account the bias which is created by the fact that you select only the distant stars. So using spectrophotometric data from RAVE, Apogee, Lamost, compilation by Pastel, ApoCASC, which mixes asteroseismology and Apogee data. And then the LSMC that I already mentioned. Also the auxiliary solutions, it was also done in this. Making a weighted average of that, perhaps by chance, but I find the same value as the one found with the global zero point of the QSOs. That's why I think the minus 0.04 is what we have for the moment. The median of all this is minus 0.14. This is also consistent with the internal method that I mentioned earlier with the parallax deconvolution. So we did also we use also distant clusters, work done by Antonella Vanellari. So, splitting north source, you can find a difference, but when you do a better cluster membership, this difference vanishes. It's no more significant, so that's not conclusive. I'm just repeating what was just shown before. So just to say that there's been a lot of work dedicated to this question of zero point. It's important to remember that this zero point, global zero point, is also a mix of local problems. So when you have data, and this data that I showed before, for some of the data here, for instance, probably this is over a whole sky, this also. But here, this one may be on a small part of the sky, so you may have local problems besides the problems on the photometric data itself. And it's even more true in very small regions, which may have angular correlations. The comparison with proper motions, so that's chi-square here, the comparison between TGAS and Hipparchos, that's okay, and to with VLBI also. Comparing with Tycho 2 proper motion, you find differences. So it's not significant. It's in ecliptic longitude, and I think that it's better seen on equatorial, because obviously this comes from Tycho 2, And inside Takutu, this probably comes from the carte du ciel astrographic catalog, which you know was done by 18 observatories of the world, which all had their own declination range. This one. This one is the Vatican Roma one. So reduction made by the Vatican nuns. And so maybe God is biased. But my point here is that it's impressive because it's a total difference in probe motion. And to be fair, what was before, the slide before, to be fair, this is not that significant. Because I mean that's a question that you may ask. If there's a problem in Tycho 2 probe motion, that means in the Tycho 2 solution, the Tycho 2 positions themselves may have some imprint of this, and so as the Tycho 2 position were used for TIGAS, it could be also. It's obviously much more reduced, and it was not really significant. There were comparisons done with the galaxy model also. No real problem except in the model itself that was known in the probe motion, and also for the parallax, perhaps for brighter stars, it was a problem which was found, but otherwise it was comparable. Yeah. Okay. So in the there's a small number of objects for which you may have a bad probe motion. That's for close double stars below 2 arcseconds. And you can see it as a function of the orientation of your pair. You can see that it can go up to 90 arcseconds. And the interpretation of that, that's a small number of objects. But the interpretation is easy, 2 arcseconds divided by the time span between Hipparchos and Gaia, it gives you 90 mass per year. So it means that the first epoch star which should have been used for TIGAS in these pairs of stars was the wrong one. Again, that's a small number of objects, but it's good to know that you may have such problems. I won't go for the DR1 position for the billion objects. Just to say that it was compared to URAT1 and ICRF QSO. There's some correlation which is found with magnitude and number of observations, which is still unclear and larger than expected outliers. Now, the photometry, the obviously Gaia will be too good, this is very difficult to check the photometry. External data need transformation, which had uncertainty, so it's difficult to check, and so you need some internal methods in some sense. Just to show the, as a function of magnitude, the precision of the function of magnitude, as a function of number of observation and over the sky, so it, in ecliptic coordinates again. We saw this graph yesterday of the uncertainty given in the catalog, just to show the excursion that you have here due to gates, saturations, or change of window size, or things like that. And so we did some internal comparison. One here is using BP and RP, making a spline, a robust spline, G minus GRP as a function of the color, and then computing the residuals between this between the observed color and the predicted one. For stars unridden, or at least at high galactic latitude. So you can see as a function of magnitude that you see some effects, also the peak at 11. So there are correlations between the photometry, it's unclear, but you see that you may get some systematics at the several millimagnitude level. So okay, it's internal. So let's have a look at external comparison. So doing the same thing with G minus Hipparchos photometry as a function of the color. You can see here the as a function of B minus V. The red points here are those with a large uncertainty, so that's expected that that look outlying. You see also some systematic at a few millimagnitude level. That's for the bright stars. For the faint one, using SDSS, you find also so the same method, so G minus R versus G minus I. And you see at magnitude 16, that's unclear whether that's SDSS saturation or change of window class in the Gaia data. But you see some trend at the level of the uncertainties. And this is seen also with the Yogel data. Same thing, it was done in clusters with other photometry. I made also another experiment for the precision, the uncertainty itself. I won't enter into details for that, but just trying to get small samples using the BP and RP magnitudes and trying to get very small samples of 1 millimagnitude in that and subtracting the median G so that to get some sample around the magnitude which would represent only, quoting only, the residuals. As you can see, it gives something at the millimagnitude level. And it is as I expect, related to the standard uncertainty by the fact that the observed variance is some interesting variance which depends obviously of the fact that all those stars are not identical, plus the unit weight error square times the standard uncertainty square. And as you can see, it's indeed the fact. And so from this, I find that at the uncertainties and the magnitudes are the unit weight is at most 1.7. And that's perfect for this, that's the uncertainty square here. For the less precise stars, for the most precise stars, it may be slightly underestimated. And then the variability, it was also compared between, so two things were done. First thing was to check whether the constant variable stars had the same properties. So that the parallaxes were not affected by variability and no correlation was found by Sergi Blanco. And he also did a comparison interpolating Ogle magnitude, which actually are more dispersed in surveys than Gaia, and checking whether the average magnitudes, amplitudes were in agreement, and also the time between minima and maxima were also, and he found no problem. So to finish with, year one is a clear, nice proof of concept that Gaia is really working. There were several trade-offs that were also mentioned, in the Lennart paper. The trade-off, small tight span, so it means that you had to use bright stars. And bright stars are the worst case because they are saturated, so including for photometry, it was complicated to do the calibration. You had attitude perturbed model and other unmodeled effects, which increased the systematics. Problem with the cross-matching, which was also based by the initial initial catalog used. And also the fact that all stars had to be considered as single. So this explains the effects that we can see. But given all this, this is clearly the best that could be achieved. So I mentioned only the problems which are found because it's important for the users to be aware of what you can find. But I think, as Anthony said on the first day, that's that's the deep competence and motivation which allowed to do that in this short time scale. So validation has watched at the data. And so who will validate the validation? And the answer is the users. So you will find whether we did not find some problems or whether we were too pessimistic for other ones. Thank you.